Oh, my God. If there was ever a topic I need to talk about today, it is this one. You know, we pray and we ask God to show us the vision that he has for us and that we want to be obedient to do that. But you can hear this song in the background that I give myself away. You hear it so you can use me. Yeah. Yes, God, so you can use me. And we say, here I am. We want to give it all, don't we? Lord have mercy, give myself away. I want to just share that briefly with you right now because we got so many people who think that they're giving themselves away to God when actually they're giving themselves away to a whole bunch of staff suckers. And I wanted to make sure that this message got out, and especially on the number of the day that it is. It's the number 7 of, you know, I thanking God over and over again about his mercy, you know, because where we are right now, this number 7 is a very serious number because some of us are having revisitation of issues and sicknesses in our bodies, and the things are coming back to visit us, or we're being, you know, visited by old seasonal things that we thought was gone. But this number 7, the fullness, the completeness is what this number stands for, the perfecting. And it's very important to make sure that we pay attention to this number. And when we're talking about today, about giving ourselves away, as I began to pray and seek God about the message that you need to hear today, he primarily wanted me to make sure that I tell my testament briefly about giving myself away. You know, many of us have given ourselves away to a whole bunch of stuff, suckers, like I said early on. And in this topic, I'm just kind of talking about time and contentment. Time and contentment means a lot, especially to those who really love God and want to give their lives to the Lord. Now, my lesson for you today that I want to talk about briefly as it relates to time and contentment. Many of us are not content. Many of us are still doing a whole bunch of things that we shouldn't be doing. Many of us know that God has not really told us to do a thing, and we continue to do those things for whatever reason. It could be to look super spiritual or whatever, but God is speaking, and he wants us to recognize that some of these priorities that we're thinking that he has told us to do, they are not. And so I can tell my testimony in just a few minutes about that, but I want to give you this poetic message or this, how they say, a word of wisdom from the person named Lin Yutang. And I thought it was real powerful for this message. And it says, besides the noble art of getting things done, there is the noble art of leaving things undone. Some wisdom of life consists in the elimination of non-essentials. I thought that was very powerful because we need to look at a whole bunch of things that we're doing. It is not going to be fruitful because in a lot of these things we want to do for whatever reason, like I said, for that we choose, that we have listened to our own spirits rather than that is our own soulish realm, because God is not speaking to us from the soulish realm of something that is not complete yet. We need to make sure that we look at those things. So very important. Now, I want to kind of jump right into this message to talk about the need to look at what you're doing is intentional. That means it is completely all God and none of you, and that you're intentionally doing what God has called you to do, because life is short. And you and I both can agree that we are fragile in a whole lot of ways when we're looking at some things that we're overworking ourselves about. And I love how James 4:14 tells us, in just giving a parable, you know, I'm paraphrasing, that life is short and you and I are as fragile as the mist that appears for a brief time. And then what? It evaporates. It is gone. And so we got to make sure that what it may look like may not be what God is saying. So we got to make sure we're looking in the spirit and that we're hearing in the spirit what God is telling us to do. And so when we start to think about how the demands come to us in our lives, that we feel that we need to do some of these things, like I talked a while back about false burdens, many of these things that we are doing intentionally are they're not God's priority. So we find ourselves allowing ourselves to get into a whole lot of things that we feel that we need to take care of right now when we spend this time that God has not even allowed for us intentionally to do. And so we think about priority and live it intentionally. The scripture is full of all types of scriptures that we can go back to looking at living purpose. consciously and living strategically so the enemy won't have us overworked and wore out. If you look at Ecclesiastes, let's look at chapter 11 and verse 6. It talks about Solomon saying that in the morning you sow your seed, and in the evening you do not withhold your hands. And if you do not know which will prosper, either this or that, he said, or whether both alike will be good. So that means you need to think, okay, what am I doing now that is so intentional and so purpose-driven that I know that if I'm wore out, I'm tired about it, where am I in this thing? Why did I do this today? And what purpose is this? You know, is this God's design for me to do this today? Or am I thinking that I really need to get this done based on, you know, I don't want to be put to shame. I don't want to do something that people are not believing that is really God. So I got to make sure that this thing looks godly when God, you know, within yourself. It is not by God. It is by your flesh. I don't want to preach. Lord, help me. Been there. Done that. And so in the New Testament, Apostle Paul wrote for us to what? He said, so be very careful how you live. Do not live like those who are not wise, but live wisely. Use every chance you have for doing good, because these are evil times. And I'll just paraphrase that. That's Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. So if we don't consciously, you think about this, in prayer, establish what God is trying to show us to do, that it's supposed to be intentionally, that what he's telling us to pursue, and how important it is for us to make sure we do those things and those things only, and when he says do them, so that we can have our priorities in check, and so that the power and the wisdom of God can flow, so we won't allow all these other things and all these other people that are coming in our way telling us, I heard God say this, you need to be doing this, I heard that. You need to know that you heard God for yourself. That's no way to live on what somebody else is saying to you, prophesying to you, or somebody else saying you need to be doing. So that we do not consciously, as I said earlier on, establish the intentional pursuit about what is important and what is the priority, you know, so we won't forfeit the power and the anointing on our lives that God can use. It's very important for us to look at that. So I want to kind of give this, and I'm going to close out, because this 7 day is so important for me too, to make sure that I won't be on here going beyond what he wants me to do. But I do know one thing, it's very important that we look at the fact that we can give our, you know, our time, but are we really giving the anointing of the time that God has for us? And so I want to share a little bit about what happened with me. You know how you go and you say, oh, I know God wants me to do this, and I'm going to do this or that. But we'll go into where God is sending us. Before you know it, we've overextended ourselves. And that's what I did one time. I never forget that. I wanted to go in and help a sister with her ministry. And before I knew it, now I'm over there helping her put things together, helping her set things up. That's not even what God asked me to do. He asked me to go in and give her wisdom on how to do the thing, because she asked me to come and help. Now, I went a step further. Now, here I am. If you want me to do that, if you want me to take up the offer, you want me, you know, I went beyond what God told me to do. So now I've overextended myself, and now my good works that God wanted me to do, now I got a bitterness about it. I got what you call servitude about it. I got an attitude, because I'm feeling like, oh, I got to do all this here. Lord, they need to go on. You know, within yourself, you know that you're tired and you overextended yourself. I don't want to go too far with this. I just want to make sure I stay where he wants me to go. You get what I'm talking about. So you forget about, you know, the extended time, the drive to where you're going, the gas that you're spending, you know, how many hours that you would spend that's taking you away from your family, taking you away from your ministry, your own ministry, and just pulling you out, giving yourself away to something God did not permit you to give yourself away about. That time and commitment is very important, because many of us spend a whole lot of time, many of our priorities in spending this time is out of order. So we don't tend to live intentionally, because we operate out of this perception of lack. This perception that, in other words, our actions are dictated not by what we believe, but by what we believe we lack. It's very important that you look at this, because some people believe that they don't have enough time to do anything, but really they got the time, because most of us know that we all are trying to do what God called us to do in that time, and everybody got the same amount of time, 24 hours in a day. But we want to say, oh, I just don't have the time, I don't have enough time. That's because you've overextended yourself. You begin to find excuses about things you know that God wants you to do, but you've overextended yourself and doing things, and now you don't feel content. You don't feel good about it. You don't feel that this is getting anywhere, because you have extended your time in something that God did not call you to do. And you think about all the, you know, these legends, Martin Luther King and so many others that are strategically, you know, running races even now that are alive. You think about, how did they get to do all these things? How did they get to do all these things within 24-hour period. You know why? Because they were very, very strategic about their time. They didn't let the people waste their time. They stayed focused to the thing. Now, were they so focused that there was no earthly good? I don't know. But I do know one thing. As the time is being spent now with what we're doing, many of these things, we're coming away, we're leaving our families, we're going doing stuff. And I talked about the other day, you know, having church all day long, all night long. And, you know, and preachers that do this, having church, you know, all night and say the move of God is here, nobody should be moving. You know, here it is, 9, 10 o'clock, the kids got to go to school in the morning on a Sunday. Come on now, that is not God. I'm just sorry. You know, some things I believe that God would have us intentionally to do by the power of his presence, but these things that is out of order, such as having babies going to sleep on the benches because y'all running around and hollering, turn around 3 times and, you know, and saying God, saying this, that, oh yeah, God may be speaking, but you got to use wisdom. I never forget that I had spent all this time, my pastor said, telling me, oh, we're going to be up in here a good while now. You better let God make a path for them kids. And so I had to have a meeting with him, let him know, look, Pastor, I all due respect, but I live way in the woodlands. Not the woodlands. I live way in Walden off of 1960. And I was going out. My church was in the south. And I told him, I have to have a meeting with you, Pastor, because I got to talk about this time. This time that I had to get my granddaughter, she was living with me at the time. This time that I had to get her in the house. She can't sleep. She's a big girl. I got to pack her in because she's so sleepy and tired. I can't have walk, you know. And then I get in there and I got to demand that she take a shower or a bath that night because she has to get up so early in the morning. She wouldn't have time. No. No, I got to talk to you now to let you know that at 8:45, I've got to get out of here. So they give me 15 minutes to get us in the car, and then we should be home by 9:30. That's still real late as far as I'm concerned. Time is very important. And you got to make sure that you evaluate your time to see what's being impactful for the world to pull down hell versus what is being impactful for your own prideful self to make sure that you show in how spiritual you are. You need to make sure you look at these things. I'm trying not to talk loud, but I want to make sure this come across very clear. You know, I'm not angry or anything. I'm just, this is just how the line of Judah come through me. When I'm trying to make sure people understand, you know, we're in time right now. The time is very, very essential. Time is very important. We must prioritize time for commitment. Slowing it down. And so the secret to living an intentional life is in large part of being associated with and developing an attitude of contentment. And if we look at the virtual life that we're in right now, where everybody's on the computer, everybody's doing live Facebook, and everybody's on, you know, Instagram, and everybody's just texting. You got to look at the fact that we're spending more time on these virtual things than we are probably even saying hello to your husband or your wife or saying good night, because you own the internet, you own the virtual pieces that God is saying, where's your time with your family? Where's your time, you know, spending with you, you know, what you're supposed to be doing that I told you to do? Where's your time in study? Where's your time in prayer? Where's your time in fasting? Oh, I know there's no commitment. There's no contentment because we're so full of ourselves that we have no time to hear what God is really telling us to do now. I'm trying to slow it down. So the secret part of this is learn to say no. You know, learn to say no, but we're born in this discontentment because we start from the very beginning with Adam and Eve. They weren't content with the beauty of the garden. They weren't content with what God is trying to show them, all that he has given them. No, they want to go and test out something else to see how much more wise they can get. Oh, yeah, we need that. But we were not born content, but we can become content in every circumstance. Why? Because whether it's going to be how the Bible says in Philippians 4:11-12, it says, you know, whether we had a lot or not, we need to make sure that we need to be able to be content in that God has given us. Many of us are not content because we're so deliberately trying to see what we can get out of this. What precious reward am I going to get out of this? You know, how am I going to be recognized? You know, we look at these things that are naturally tangible rather than the spirit realm that God is trying to take us. And so we need to be more than just aware of these things. We need to be intentionally active and continually appreciative of these things that God has given us, the beauty of the world to get up and see how the beautiful trees and even the rain, you know, or whatever the storm. We need to know that our daddy's big at everything. But we need to be more contently and intentionally appreciative about it. We need to be thanking God for the water, thanking him for our health, thanking him for the opportunity we can go and turn the water on and take a bath, thanking him for the food, thanking him for just to have the eyes to witness the beauty of the world, you know, thanking him for how he's given us an opportunity to prioritize, thanking him to show us, you know, that and how he can show us that we can focus if we ask him on a particular thing. But these things seem not to matter to us because we're not content. You know, these things seem not to matter because we're too busy trying to give ourselves away in places and to people that we have no business. And so I want you to go away with this. When you think about the thanksgiving of the Lord and focus on those matters and think about the principle of the things that we need to consider in our lives, that they are all gifts from God and these signs that he's pointing us to say, come up here, my daughter, my son, come up higher. That means set yourself down, get on your knees if you need to, get the Bible and begin to pray. Lord, help me to understand what you want from me now. My time is almost up. But another powerful exercise you can do besides that, you can begin to look at what God is saying to you about writing these things down, prioritizing these things. And you need to look at it and notice, where are you? You know, are you really loving what you're doing? Are you really rejoicing what God has told you to do? Or are you just feeling bitter and tired and broken behind that thing? Then you're going to know that discontentment, that discomfort, God is trying to show you this is not for me. And so the powerful way that I described a few minutes ago is beginning to set yourself down. Look at your priorities. Look at what you want to do to try to make it look like that I'm really there for you. I'm really there trying to help you. Or is this what God is telling you to do? Everybody got a way that they feel they can show someone that they care. Everybody got a reason why they are connected with others. Everybody know that God is giving us some things that we think is too hard. You know, that we don't want to walk through that door. We don't want to do this or that because we're not content. We don't feel comfortable. But the Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes 9:11, I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill, but time and chance happened to them all. And so we need to understand that. I want to also give you this piece, and I'm going to close out, about exercising your contentment, looking into your time. And so listen to this, and it's by St. Augustine, and it's in his prayer book. And this is what he said. And I'm going to start out just like he said. And so you go back and you repeat this when this is off this piece I'm giving you today for day 7, which is very significant, as I said, because it's a day of completion. You know, you don't want things to keep going so bad that God got to expose you in public when he's trying to show you the day to complete the thing based on what he told you to do. And so this is what his message says. It says, just for the day, Lord, for tomorrow and its needs, I do not pray. Keep me, he said he did not pray for that. Keep me, my God, from the stain and sin just for the day. Let me both diligently work and duly pray. Let me be kind in word and deed. Just for today. Let me be slow to do my will, prompt to obey. Help me to sacrifice myself just for today. And if today my tide of life should ebb away, give me thy sacraments divine, sweet Lord, today. So for tomorrow and its need, I do not pray, but keep me, guide me, love me, Lord, just for today. And so I'm out of here. I'm praying that this message has helped you. Remember, you will not have the contentment and you will not be able to prioritize until you do what God is telling you to do intentionally. Remember, priorities that are not of God, thinking that you're going to be in lack when actually you was in lack already when you did what you weren't supposed to do. Time and commitment is very important. But the only way you're going to be able to have this thing complete, it's making sure you prioritize, making sure you get these things in order, making sure that you live and serve and not give yourself away to the wrong person, but do these things intentionally. Why? Because you do not want to operate out of the spirit of perception of the lack. You want to operate and believe God that you know that all things are perfect and well for where he's taking you. Remember, the race is not given to the swift. He wants to make sure you understand, but you've got to have the skill to know how to prioritize so that you can do all he's called you to do. So make sure you check yourself to see if you're too busy, you're too tired, you're too available. Check that out. And then God will show you where the discontentment has come so he can pour fresh oil on you and you can be content and you can be happy about what you're doing. And now you're able to share your ministry and your family have the time that they so deserve because you've been too unavailable. God bless you.